Time now for our weekly segment on science and technology, the leading edge. And this week, Hari Sreenivasan is here with an update on a pair of important stories.
There are important findings and analyses on a pair of stories we've long been covering, the health of bees and the impacts of climate change. A recent study looked at the economic consequences of climate change and concluded it will make the U.S. poorer and more unequal if present trends continue. The South would be hit the hardest. A different set of studies looked at the health of bees in connection to insecticides used in crops. Bees are critical for our global food production. Honeybees alone are responsible for pollinating $15 billion of U.S. crops. The new papers demonstrated the popular insecticide used in agriculture called neonicotinoids can be harmful to bees. Miles O'Brien is with us once again. Miles, you know, we've been looking at, or scientists have been thinking about, the chemicals that are used in insecticides as kind of one of the number one culprits for colony collapse for a long time. So what's so new about these studies?
Well, you're right, Hari. There have been a lot of studies in the past looking at bees and these insecticides, which are coated on the seeds and absorbed, they call it systemic, to the plants. They've been widely used for a decade, an alternative to spraying insecticides on the plant as they grow. The concern is that it can harm pollinators, but so far that's only been a theory in the lab. So separate teams in Europe and Canada tested the possible link between these neonics and bee losses in the field for the first time. They placed bee colonies close to crops that had been treated with the neonicotinoids and other colonies far away from agriculture. They sampled a variety of specimens, pollen, nectar, larvae, bees themselves, of course. And they say the insecticide is not only found in the crops they are meant to protect, but it spreads to other plants in the area that are attractive to bees, and it persists for months.
So how does it affect the bees and what happens to the whole colony?
That's the key question, connecting those dots. Researchers at York University in Ontario did a second test in the laboratory mimicking what they found in the field. They exposed bees to a small amount of the neonicotinoid-infused pollen, and those bees stopped, get this, maintaining the hygiene of their hive. Typically, bees will remove sick or dead bees, but the insecticide-exposed bees, for some reason, stopped doing this, leaving sick bees inside the hive. And the beehive became a pigsty, if you will. I caught up with Nadia Setkoff, one of the lead authors of the York University study.
What we found in our study was that worker bees from exposed colonies died 23% sooner. So that's a very big hit to the colony. They also had abnormal foraging behaviors. We found also that the colonies had a difficulty replacing a queen. So over time, we had more and more queenless colonies, which, unless there is an intervention, the colonies will perish.
At first blush, this study seems to put to rest the neonic collapse debate. But in a separate study, also published last week, a European team found some bee colonies in Germany that thrived, even though they were close to fields with neonic-treated crops. This led researchers to believe there must be some other geographical or environmental factor in play. Maybe some bees are more susceptible to the toxins, depending on their location, for example. In short, the study suggests the effects of neonics on bees are inconsistent. But that study was funded in part by the German chemical and pharmaceutical giant Bayer, which happens to be the maker of neonicotinoids. Now, in a statement, Bayer says it remains convinced that neonicotinoid seed treatments have no short or long-term negative effects on bees, and that these seed treatments are a useful and effective tool for farmers.
In the totally different category of climate science, there was a big study this week, and usually when climate studies come out, we're looking at environmental impacts. But what was interesting about this one was it was looking at economic impacts. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, this one is a very impressive study on climate change. Scientists in the climate realm teamed up with economists, the dismal science meeting climate science, if you will, and they looked at the economic impacts of climate change as you project out to the future. And perhaps the most interesting finding was that climate change will hit different socioeconomic classes differently. Here's Berkeley scientist and lead author of the study, Solomon Shung.
In the South, where it's hot and along the coast, we might see populations losing the equivalent of 20% of their income. Whereas in the cooler northern and western regions, we actually see that populations might benefit a little. And because the North tends to be wealthier and the South tends to be poorer, what we see is that in the future, climate change is going to increase economic inequality within the United States.
So how does the U.S. fare overall?
Well, the team estimates that for each degree Fahrenheit increase in global temperatures, the U.S. economy overall loses about 0.7% of gross domestic product, with each degree of warming costing more than the last as you go up. So the U.S. as a whole is not a winner economically.
So does it break down by industry? Say, for example, agriculture might be hit harder, or real estate?
Well, agriculture, especially in the Midwest, will likely suffer immensely. That seems obvious. But it could be comparable to the Dust Bowl in the 1930s, according to these researchers. Of course, real estate on the coastline, that's another obvious one. But here's a surprise. The team found the biggest economic impact of climate change was in healthcare. They expect people living in the South especially will be hit more with heat-related complications like heat stroke. Managing that and dealing with the victims is, of course, very expensive.
And this is happening to a population that's already poorer than the general average in the United States.
And there's the vicious cycle.
All right. Miles O'Brien, thanks so much.
You're welcome, Hari.